Sir Robert Peel had 9 principles, and principle number 7 says, police at all times should maintain a relationship with the public and gives reality to the historic tradition that police are the public and the public are the police being only members of the public who are paid to give full-time attention to the duties which are incumbent on every citizen in the interest of community welfare and existence. The reason I do Tillman's Takes is for that reason, and that reason alone is because even though I am a police officer, I'm still a member of the public.
Yo, we going out. Episode of the ITSNEEDED podcast.
We talk about the police and the community.
The police and the community. It's your boy Grayson.
And I'm 6 years old today.
Happy
birthday, Grayson.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, how old are you today, boy?
6.
Yeah, what are we doing?
6.
Going to SeaWorld to spend the night.
That's what I'm talking about. All right, man. Get up out of here, big boy, and go play with your little radio.
That's a special introduction right there.
Yeah, big boy. All right, I'll see you guys in a minute. Give me kisses. What's going on, guys? How you guys doing, man?
Hey, that's an intro right there. They weren't expecting that.
Nah, man. I had to let my son do it, man. He's been begging to be on this podcast, man. He always asks me, like, Dad, like, when can I be on the podcast, man? Like, I'm trying to be on the podcast. And so my boy turned 6 today, and so we definitely had to get my little man on today. So that's my boy Grayson for you guys out there. If you guys are new listening to this podcast, that's my son. He's 6 today. So I'm trying to train him well, trying to train my boy right so he already knows what's good when he gets older.
The funny part about it is he's got the personality. Like the way he hit that, yo, what's up, y'all?
You hear him though? You hear him? He be in his room practicing, man. So, man, AJ, what is up, my brother?
Man, I cannot call it, brother. I cannot call it. It's an early recording today. So for those of you who don't know, it's 10 o'clock my time. I can't complain because it's like 6:40 something Ryan's time. So. Bruh. I don't got no excuse. I got my coffee right here. We're going to be good.
Bruh, the Savage showed up at my door at like 6 o'clock this morning like, what's up, y'all?
That's a Jehovah's Witness time right there.
Oh, bruh. It was early, bro. Yeah. My boy, the Savage was up early, dog. I was just like, man. So, nah, but this is early. Hey, the reason we're doing it so early, like I told you guys, I'm taking my family out. And I want to first and foremost tell you guys, sorry that we did not have an episode last week. I mean, that was the first time ever that we've actually missed a week that we've always been scheduled to produce. So, just so you guys know, man, like, I was, your boy was hurting. I was sick, so awful. And I was contemplating in my mind, I was like, man, should I just allow like Billy to come over into this infirmary and just get all types of sick? And so the kids had it, I had it, the wife had it. It was bad. I'm about to tell y'all a story about that in a minute, but it was bad. So forgive us for not recording, but I was not going to let another week go by without not having a podcast. This podcast is so important. I also thank you guys because me and AJ have gotten inundated with just messages after messages about how this podcast has helped change their life, how it's helped people get hired in the law enforcement. I had somebody hit me up last week and they said they replayed the suicide episode like 4 times and how they showed up at somebody's door who was feeling suicidal and just talked about how they matter. And so thank you guys for just really embracing this podcast as being something that you enjoy looking forward to because it just really makes me and AJ go and it gives us that motivation. And even Billy gives us that motivation to just continue to push, man. So thank you for that, man. So AJ, what's new on your end, my brother?
Oh, brother, I cannot call it, man. I heard you got some fires out there, man. What's up with that?
Bro, this is California, man. So the two things that California will get is fires and earthquakes. And so you could definitely count on California to give you one of those two things. Now, tornadoes, blizzards, hurricanes, we don't mess with that stuff.
Is it like as serious as like the news here is making it seem? Because the news here is making it seem like Cali is on fire. Like Cali is burning down right now.
So let me put it like this. It's bad, but it's bad in those areas. But like California, gotcha. But Cali is so big, like so where we're at, like we don't see no smoke. Like, But
don't see no smoke.
Nah, we don't see no smoke where we're at. But it is bad though. Like, they're shutting freeways down there, evacuating. Like last year, what was it? The Paradise? What was that community called? Anyway, one of the communities, it was a real bad fire, bro. It looked like a freaking nuclear bomb just like took the city out. So, but it was funny though. Me and my wife were tripping out though. Like, we were watching the news the other day. So this dude is on there and he was like, and I'm assuming he was a resident. He was like, I think it was like Pacific Palisades or something. He was like, man, this is just supposed to be an enchanted community where it's just people just come to just love and just, this is where we move here to just experience paradise. And I'm like, yeah, thanks for just calling out all of us peasants that can't afford to live in Pacific Palisades.
Right. Now. Y'all supposed to be immune to natural disasters.
Yeah, that's why y'all probably going up in flames right now, because y'all forgot about the little people down here that can't afford to live up in the Palisades. So man, it was funny because me and my wife looked at each other. We were like, did you just kind of catch what I? He was like, this is just this enchanted community and it's just overtaken by the flames and stuff like that. I'm like, thanks for all the folks in the hood. Yeah, thanks for all the people in the hood that can't afford that.
Oh man, what's up with you though, man?
Man, same with you, man. I can't call it, bro. There's been so much that's gone on since the last time we talked. And just so you guys know, I haven't even talked to AJ. Like, so, like, as we're talking right now, like, mm-hmm. we're legitimately like catching up. Like, I ain't talked to AJ in like a week and a half at least. And so, but
yeah, for sure.
Not much, man. Just been busy with school. Last night we had our rival football game, and so I didn't get home till like midnight because folks was out there tripping last night, bro. Like,
oh man,
like people at halftime, they were throwing food at each other over like the fence where the concession stands are, and then they were start throwing like little boats of ketchup. So folks was getting like drenched with ketchup. So I was like, man, it's. After this game is over, man, it's about to go down.
It's gonna be bad, yeah.
And sure enough, man, they all walk to the front stadium, and then these two girls, bro, just start scrapping. It was like the smoking gun, because as soon as that happened, just all heck broke loose, bro. Like, everybody was everywhere. We had to call the helicopter out. It was just ridiculous, bro. So we had that, and then. But on another note, I do real quick, briefly, got to say, and Billy, I'm gonna need you to edit. You know, some music into this podcast, but I am officially a new favorite fan of my boy Kanye West.
Closed on Sunday. My Chick-fil-A.
Hey, we got to edit that in here, bro. I don't think y'all understand the significance of why I'm such a fan of Kanye again. The reason I'm a fan of Kanye is simply for one reason. My man is being adamant about and outspoken about his faith in Jesus Christ. Now, if you've listened to this podcast for a while, you know me and AJ are very outspoken about our faith. And so for Kanye West to be so outspoken about his faith is really a pinnacle, because that man is at a platform in a culture that is in complete opposition, not just to Jesus Christ, but just to doing good and right anyway. And so the mere fact that he's come out and just said, hey, look, I'm gonna be different. I don't know, have you watched the documentary on it?
I haven't.
Or not the documentary, but the interview, bro. It's crazy. He says, like, look, man, I became a slave. He said the culture became a god to me. He was like, before I used to think that I was the god of the culture, but I didn't realize is that I was a god. The culture became a god to me. He was like, I knew I had a problem when I had my youngest daughter competing, like, in how she dressed with Rihanna. He was like, when I realized like I have my daughter competing on how her style with Rihanna, I was like, man, like what is going on? So he even compared himself, you know, to Nebuchadnezzar in the Old Testament about how he was just trying to make his kingdom just bigger, and he was like, and he talks about his dome being so high and that his dome had to be lowered because, you know, God was like, no, I'm God, I'm the one that's in charge, bro. So and then he even went out to say, he was like, man, like the album, when he created his latest album, he was like, I was telling people that were working on this album, like, man, if you're engaged in premarital sex, I need y'all to stop.
Yeah.
He was like, I need y'all to cut that. He was like, because I need y'all to pray and fast because I want y'all to be in the spirit as much as possible because I want this album to be straight from the spirit. So I was just like, so one thing that I took from that, or there's a lot of stuff I took from it, but here's the one thing before we start getting all deep into this podcast. The one thing I took from that is like, that's an example, man, of doing, going against the norm, like doing something that is not, that is contrary to popular belief. You know what I mean? And so for kids out there, I told a kid yesterday, you know, right now in high schools and middle schools, the popular thing is to vape. The popular thing is to pop Xanny bars. We arrested a girl yesterday who had almost over 20 some odd Xanny bars on a high school campus yesterday. So it's like, so these are all these popular trends that kids are doing, you know, one to smoke, one to do Xannies, one to drink, one to do all this other stuff. And I'm like, man, it's okay to not do those things. And it's okay to make not doing those things popular. You know what I mean? So Kanye West is living proof. Kanye West, a guy that was living in a culture that promoted, like, he even talks about, man, like why he moved to Wyoming. He was saying, man, like, I moved to Wyoming because when I come out here and I drive, I can just sense God's spirit over this place, and it's the land and the beauty.
Oh, wow.
And he was like, whereas in L.A., he was like, in L.A., man, you look at the billboards. On one end, you see billboards just advertising all this alcohol and spirits and stuff like that. And then he was like, on the other end, you see advertisements for strip clubs. And then he was like, well, we don't even realize. He was like, that's trafficking just on a different level. He was like, because what happens is these guys go into these strip clubs, they sell alcohol, and then they pay for all these women and dancers and stuff like that. And then at the end of the night, the manager of the club is asking, hey, what was our traffic like? He was like, that's still trafficking on a whole nother level. And I was like, wow, like I never even thought of it like that. So he was, it just blew my mind. Like, man, like God is working on that dude. So if you're listening to this podcast, if you're a Christian, if you're, you know, if you're not a Christian, whatever, man, pray for that man right there, because he is going to be under attack. He probably already is under attack. And so, man, shout out to Kanye West, man. Billy, make sure you put some Kanye West, man. That's my Chick-fil-A up on
that's
this.
That's my Chick-fil-A. Yeah. So,
what's your thoughts on that, AJ?
Well, first off, if I ever get as rich as Kanye West, I'm also going to hire a whole Sunday service to follow me around.
Hey.
And we just going to turn up in random places. We're going to invite people and whatnot. But yeah, you're right, man. Like the culture of hip hop as a whole, not all of it, but as a whole is in danger and in a dark place. And for Kanye to be who he is in that culture and to put out an entire album called Jesus is King, and it's a gospel album.
It is. There's not one cuss word on that album.
Right. And he kept postponing the album even up until the day of the release. Like it was supposed to come out Friday at midnight. What's that? Friday. And he kept pushing it back. He's like, nope. He's like, I want to tweak this just because he wanted to make sure it was right. So yeah, I mean, he's really leading the way. I mean, aside from him putting this out, I would say the next major artist would be Lecrae.
Yep.
And you know, he's big time, and he's always been a Christian rapper as far as I know. But I can't imagine what they face, like as far as like the opposition and what the devil does. So yeah, definitely pray for them. And if you have some sort of like ill thought in your mind, like, oh, you know, Kanye, this is just a publicity stunt, blah, blah, blah. Like, keep in mind how many millions of listeners Kanye West has a month. Millions of listeners Kanye has a month. And how many people are hearing the words, Jesus is King now.
And not only that, he even said, he was like, on that documentary, maybe we'll upload the documentary so people can go at least download the link. But he was like, he talked about basically all these accomplishments he has. He was like, man, I have all these accomplishments. He was like, I'm a billionaire. He was like, I have this, I have that. He was like, I'm not going to allow somebody to take my opinion away about how I feel about God. Mm-hmm. He's like, I don't care. He's like, I don't care. And so, and the cool thing about it was, is I still remember when Kanye first came out, because even when the secular Kanye, Yeah. I was a huge fan of Kanye. Only reason I stopped following Kanye. Yes, bro. And in that song, when Kanye was like, Jesus walks, he says, one day everybody in the club screaming out, Jesus walks.
Yep.
And so it's funny because you almost see his journey. Like, at the beginning, you can see, like, he was at, you know, that's what he felt in his heart. But yet he wasn't on solid ground, like, and then yet he went through this dark period of his life. And I remember his music started getting like real, real dark. I was like, oh, like felt like demonic to me. I was like, oh, that's when I had to stop listening to him. And then you see him come back out. And so what's the takeaway from this? Like, I, you know, I don't like talking about nothing unless there's a takeaway from it. So the takeaway from it for me is like, look, like we're going to go through struggles in our life. You may go through a dark place. But the Bible says, like, God will never forget about you. Like, God will always, you know, heed your call when you call out to him. It's just a matter of you calling out to him. Like, you know, it's not a matter of, hey, God, I've done this, I've done that, I've made this mistake, I've made that mistake, God could never forgive me. Like, God uses anybody. Like, people forget, like, you know, the Apostle Paul, who wrote, and without getting all scriptural and, you know, biblical and everything, like, the Apostle Paul was one of the meanest dudes in the Bible before he became Paul, when he was Saul. Like, that dude was killing people, murdering Christians, everything like that. And God still used him as being one of the most, the biggest apostles in the Bible. And so if you're going through a dark time in your life, if you just feel like downs, if you feel like you've done, made so many different mistakes or whatever it may be, like, don't trip. Like, you can still get through it at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Just remember, at the end of the day, when you do get to it or get through it, make sure God gets the glory. Make sure Jesus Christ gets the glory, because he's the one that pulled you out of it. And he's going to be like, don't forget who brought you out of it, man. So shout out to Kanye, man. I'm super juiced right now. I told my brother-in-law, I said, man, it could be the wackest album ever, and I'll still be bumping it every, like, I'll be bumping that day, you know, and, which is not a whack album. I actually listened to the whole thing, and I actually like it, man. The lyrics are just, you know, my man. And then the other part about it, too, was just, he had other mainstream artists on it, like Clips, Ty Dolla $ign. I'm like, so what is he doing in those people's lives? Like, man. And then it's just a ripple effect. And so wherever you're at, don't ever underestimate the power of your influence.
Yeah, like, that's exactly it.
Don't
that's exactly
underestimate it. The power of your influence, because influence is a very powerful thing, and it can be used for the right reasons. It could be used for the wrong reasons. Hitler killed masses based on influence. Martin Luther King freed masses based on influence. So don't ever underestimate your influence. And then if you have a social media platform, if you're an influencer, be mindful that you have a responsibility. When you get any type of influence, and this is a topic that people need to start learning, that it's a new topic because this social media stuff is still brand new. But when you get to a certain point as an influencer, you have to realize that comes with a level of responsibility. Like, that level of responsibility is what comes out of your mouth, what comes off of your page, people are going to take that as word, as bond. And so if you're not careful with what you say or what you do, people will be influenced by that. And you can either lead people, you know, in the right direction, or you can lead people astray. And so if you have that check mark, if you have that K behind your number or followers, or if you have people that are coming to you asking you for advice, I hope you're answering that call to responsibility. Because if you're not, you need to rethink if this social media thing is something you want. Kanye said it as well. He was like, hey, man. You know, he was like, social media is becoming a god to people.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And one of his songs on that album, he even raps about it. He's like, I was on Instagram searching for likes, and I don't even like likes, or something to that effect. And I was just like, man, this dude is going crazy right now. But at the end of the day, what he did was he took his platform and he used it to do what he believes is right. So for everybody listening in law enforcement, how many times have you found yourself in a situation where people are like, whether your coworkers are this way, we're gonna go out here, we're gonna get guns and dope, and that's all we're gonna do, and they forget the community policing aspect of it, or the caring for your community aspect of it, or vice versa, right? Like, we're gonna go out here and we're gonna hug everybody, but they forget you gotta be the police as well. Do what's right. Do what's right. It's a prime example. This is you have a platform. You are a police officer. You have a humongous platform. And speaking of platforms, we gotta talk about TikTok, man. TikTok is insane.
It is.
Like, TikTok.
I was just telling Billy about that.
Bruh, So it don't take this the wrong way, man. I posted a video of me dancing on TikTok. That joint has 5 million views, and I almost have 500,000 followers on TikTok now because of that video.
That's crazy. It is crazy. Out.
Bruh, it's outrageous, man. Like, yeah, I don't know.
Dog, it's crazy. Now, the other part about that is, we definitely ain't on AJ status, so, you know. let me give y'all that disclaimer. Let me give y'all that disclaimer, because I don't want y'all thinking that my TikTok is just out of the
room. Nah, I was going somewhere. Keep going, but yeah, I'm going to go back to it. No, go ahead.
No, I was just telling Billy right before we got on today, it was funny, man. I was like, I went to the middle school yesterday because I had on something. Everywhere I was going, like, people were like, man, I can hear him in the background. Man, I follow that dude on TikTok. Coming up, yes, to me, hey, man, like, hey, I follow you on TikTok. And so I was like, wow, like, man, that is crazy. Like, you know, like, this thing is powerful, man. And it's powerful with this younger generation, man. So
big time. So the wife and I and another couple that's like friends of ours, we went to like, you're going to laugh at this. There's a story behind it. You know who Mason Ramsey is?
Uh-uh.
The Walmart yodeling kid. Remember him?
Oh, yeah.
Remember him?
Yeah, he came
up with a song called Famous. Like, yes, if I'm going to be famous.
Yeah.
Bro, we went and seen him in concert last night, all right?
I'm definitely laughing at that, bro. Oh, but even Billy shook his head. I would expect that from somebody like Billy.
Oh, man. Yeah. So anyway, there's a story behind it. It's funny. So we went just being goofy. Like, we could go see the Walmart kid at a concert, right? I walked in. Of course, it's a bunch of younger, like, teenagers and, like, young adults there. So when we get there, as soon as I walk in, there's, like, a group of girls. And I just, like, walk by them. And I don't know, they're, like, 18, 19. And my wife goes... She goes, babe, you're getting recognized. And I was like, oh, it's like, where at? She was like, right behind you. She's like, they're like literally pulling up your TikTok right now. So I turn around and one of the girls runs up to me. She goes, are you Officer Johnson? And I was like, it depends. And she was like, oh my God, can we have a picture? And it just started this whole thing. I'm like, oh my goodness. Like, hey, TikTok is crazy. But I tell you what I think I'm figuring out about TikTok. And I don't know this to be true. So if someone knows this to be true or the opposite, hit me up and let me know. But I think what TikTok is doing is I think that they're using your geolocation. So, like, they find out that you're in California and then they send your videos out to people in your area.
Because
that's what they're doing, man. Because everyone that hits me, not everyone, but a majority of people who hit me up on TikTok are from the Ohio or like Midwest region. Like, there's even like a saying on my TikTok, at least, like, Ohio runs TikTok, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I doubt it. Like, highly doubt Ohio runs TikTok.
You know, I think you're right. I'm telling you, bro, the same thing was happening to me yesterday. I'm walking around and just, I could hear the whispers. Oh, that's Officer Tillman right there. That's Officer Tillman. And then even I'm like, it's funny, I'm like standing, you know, at the halftime of the game, I'm standing like making sure these fools stop throwing, you know, freaking ketchup on each other and stuff. And there's like a fence. There's like a gate in between each other. There's like a gate. And so, not like I shouldn't call them fools, but not like that. But like, it was just.
I'm laughing at the ketchup. Like, oh, you know how mad I'd be if somebody threw a whole boat of ketchup on me?
I didn't get hit with it. But dog, anyways, I'm like, man, if y'all don't stop. No, they were acting foolish. So anyways, they're throwing ketchup. I'm standing in between. On this gate, bro. And I could just hear somebody, I could hear some kids over the gate like, hey, Officer Tillman, man, we follow you on TikTok. And I don't even go, like, it was the opposite team's fans.
Yeah.
So I don't even work at their school. So, like, I even walked into the dance teacher yesterday, kind of go talk to her about something. And she was like, man, I hear you're TikTok famous. I was like, that's what they say. I don't really know. How I just post videos on there, and so I got to. Hey, we and Billy about to. Have you done? Have you seen the 223s? Billy over here. Billy posted a TikTok video right now.
No, like, I ain't seen.
Speaking
that.
Of that, but have you seen the 223s? Talk for me.
Oh yeah.
I did it last night. Yeah.
Two, two, three. Yeah.
We got to do a challenge with each other, bro. We definitely.
Bro,
do a challenge
with each other. Bro, man, listen. This is so funny. So, let me think of how to say this without giving out too much. All right, so I'm at work last week. I'm gonna say last week. I'm at work last week.
Yeah.
And this this juvenile was playing with the gun, like trying to be cool, and he like grazed his leg with it. Like he shot the gun off and it, like grazed his leg. So, you know, trying to be gangster. So he's at the medical facility, and I walk in like right when it happened, like right when he got there, like I walk in. Cause you know, we have to show up and investigate and whatnot. So I walk in and he's screaming, like holding his leg, like, and he's an older juvenile, right? Like he ain't like a kid, he's a young adult. He's like, and like the nursing staff and like the doctors keep trying to move his leg or move his arms, and he's like cussing at him and whatnot. And I'm laughing because the kid is like low key funny. So like I let out like a big laugh because he like cussed at one of the doctors, but like in a real funny way. So I laugh and he goes, and he looks over at me and stops and goes, oh my God, you're famous. And he goes, and dude, the entire room busted out laughing, bro. Like, man. Oh man, I was in tears. I'm like, what is the world coming to? Like,
man, that, oh my God, you're famous. Bro, that's hilarious, bro.
Social media, man.
Well, did you have the number for Officer Down?
I do.
Yeah, let's do that.
On a serious note.
Because we got to have something serious for our listeners. They're like, hey.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, y'all. Hey, this is what our conversations are like with me and AJ, just be rapping on the phone when I talk on my way to work in the morning. So,
man, you ain't lying. Ryan be calling me at like 9 a.m. Like, are you up? Bro, no, I ain't up. Bro, I'm tired. Let me.
Last podcast we recorded.
I'm back. Yeah, you broke up, man. Your bootleg internet struck again. All right. The last podcast we recorded was on October 5th, and the number that we came in was 94. As of today is October 26th. We're coming in at 101. So as always, we're gonna read off these names and pay honor. Excuse me. So we lost Border Patrol Agent Robert Houghton. His end of watch was 10/6/19. He had an unidentified cause. We lost Trooper Peter Steffen from Indiana State Police. His end of watch was 10/11/19. The cause was auto crash. We lost a Deputy Sheriff Matt Jones from Falls County Sheriff's. That's in Texas. His end of watch was 10/11/19. He was struck by a vehicle. We lost Captain Albert Torres from the L.A. Department of Recs and Parks from out your way in California. His end of watch was 10/12/19 due to a heart attack. We lost Deputy Jake Almendinger. Excuse me if I butchered that last name. I apologize. From Gatlin County Sheriff's Office out in Montana. The end of watch was 10/19/19. He was also struck by a vehicle. Then we lost Deputy Brian Ishmael from El Dorado Sheriff's Department, also in California. End of watch was 10/23/19 due to gunfire.
Oh, man. And so we're at like AJ said, we're at 101. If you guys don't know, there is an initiative out there. It's called the Below 100 Initiative. And the Below 100 Initiative, its sole purpose is to try to keep police officer deaths, line of duty deaths, to a below 100 every single year. I don't think they've ever hit 100. Or below 100. We are in October and we're already over that 100 mark. So, I will say that we're down about 27% from last year to this year, but still, man, just one is too many. So, you know, my condolences to the family and the friends that lost a loved one. It's a dangerous job, and so, you know, we'll pick up the torch and carry it from here for you guys. So,
absolutely.
So transitioning, guys. So one thing I wanted to talk to you guys about today, and then actually this might even be a good lead-in about some of the current events of your life too, AJ, was just the perception of things and how we perceive things, how we see things, things that are factual, things that are perceived to be right or wrong, but just the overall perception of the way we break things down and how we have to do better as, you know, civilians to evaluate every situation as being a situation on an individual basis in and of itself. I think a lot of times as people, what we like to do, Billy, can we turn this mic up just a little bit? I can't hear myself for some reason. There we go. I think for some reason, what one of the things that we like to do as a people is we like to lump every situation in with other situations. And then we like to say, you know, well, police officers, they all do this, or community members, they all do this. And so there were two recent situations that I want to talk about, get your opinion about, AJ, and then I want to talk about some of the current events in your life. So after we had the last podcast, we talked about the Amber Geiger situation and how she was convicted and everything like that. Well, shortly after, you had the situation in 30 miles from where the Amber Geiger situation took place, you had another officer that took the life of a lady who was in her home about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, she was in there. Basically, long story short, if you guys didn't hear about this, I'm sure you did, so I'm not going to bore you with all the details. But long story short, neighbor called and said, hey, look, you know, my neighbor's door is open. It's not normal for her. So could you just come send somebody out just to do a residence check, a well-being check? If you guys don't know what a welfare check is, all it is basically, you know, they send officers to go make sure that everything is okay. You know what I mean? They don't know what the exact problem is, but just something seems off. So officers went over there. It's about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. They're searching the house. They're searching the outside of the house, which is a standard practice. Me and my partners will search the outside of a house. So that's not abnormally, that's not abnormal for officers to do. As they're searching though, you know, they go into the backyard, and then you can see the officer look into a window, and then simultaneously as he looks into the window, you can see he sees somebody inside. When he sees somebody inside, he basically says, hey, get your hands up. And then shortly after, he fires one round off, killing the innocent lady inside of her own home. As you guys can understand, there was backlash for that. And so the unfortunate part about it is that lady lost her life in her own home, again, 30 miles away from the other situation in Texas. And so I said this on our Instagram account, like, hey, officers, like, we do got to be better than that. Like, there's no excuse for that. And I get mistakes will be made. I get that this job is hard. I get that, you know, things happen. But there's no excuse for that. I mean, because, again, I talked about it when Amber Geiger lost her life. Like, how are you going to be inside your own home and doing your own thing, and then, you know, police officers show up and then kill you inside of your own home? And so the reason I brought that up alongside perception is because what people started to do and what officers started to do was, I don't think was right, is they were saying, like, hey, there was, you know, a gun involved, or she had a gun, and does that change things? Well, like, the partners even said, hey, look, there was, you know, we couldn't even see inside of it because there was a glare. So in order to actually see a gun would be hard. And then they try to paint this perception that she was some bad person and stuff like that, when in all actuality is one of those things, like, we just got to say, hey, look, like, nah, like, we screwed up. Like, we screwed up on this. Like, we don't try to change the perception of this lady and paint her out to be some type of figure that, you know, some bad person, or she presented this crazy threat to officers, which is why, you know, he pulled the trigger, when that's not the case. And at least that, now, again, I know they're doing an investigation into it. But I can tell you the chief fired him, or I think the guy resigned, but they're filing charges, criminal charges against this guy. For a reason. And so we can't go out there and start defending, you know, and saying, hey, well, there's got to be, you know, she must have posed a threat, when in all actuality, this looks like an honest to God mistake. And I think for me, if we just came out and say, hey, man, it was a mistake. Yeah, it's a mistake that's inexcusable. But at the end of the day, it's still a mistake. And being a man and just saying, like, hey, we owned up and I screwed up. Like, and that's a hard thing to do, because I'm not going to sit here and say, like, if I wasn't in their shoes, in an officer's shoes, I can't sit here and say, like, that's going to be an easy thing to do. But at the same time, if I was also in the person that lost their life shoes, I'm not going to excuse that. Like, that's not, especially if I'm a family member. But on the flip side of that, you had the recent shooting in Texas, or not in Texas, in Fresno, that recently happened. And I haven't done all the research on this one, but I do know is that the way it looks, if you watch the video, you see a guy, and again, I don't know all the back story behind this one, but you have a guy that's running and he's jumping over a fence. So as he gets over the fence, you know, you see him immediately, like, as he's running, takes a couple more steps, he falls and collapses. Well, which, if you don't realize, because there's no volume, there's an officer that's chasing him, and the officer shoots him in the head from behind, and the dude collapses and kills him. And so if you just look at the face value of that video, on all levels, it looks like, man, like, this officer just shot this dude running away from him. There's two things that people don't get from that video. The one thing is that the guy actually had a gun on him, and if you slow it down, it actually could almost be seen as if he may be reaching for the gun, whatever it may be. Actually, there's three things about this video. He's reaching, or maybe reaching for the gun. The other thing is, the place that he's just running into is that it's a daycare center. So he's running into a daycare center where there's children and all types of stuff. So that's the place, the fence he hopped over. And the biggest part about this situation that's missed, left out, is that the guy was actually wanted for a murder that occurred the day before. And so if you just watch the video, it looks bad. But then knowing all the other circumstances behind it, put yourself in the shoes of having your kid at that daycare center. Are you going to want an armed suspect running into a daycare center and you know that he just committed a murder the day before? I'm going to tell you, as a parent of three kids, heck no. Heck no. Like, stop that. And so the perception of that one is like, the video looks terrible, but the facts behind the video justify everything. So why do I bring those two videos up and compare them? Well, this is why, is because those two videos are completely different from each other. They're one, and they're just very different. But we have the tendency as humans to say, compare, well, officers all do this, or all officers shoot unarmed men, or all officers shoot people in the back, or all officers don't give people a chance. We got to stop this comparison process. And the only thing we can compare things to is situation at that time that it occurred. Like, what we can compare it to, the facts of that incident, you know, in and of itself. Like, that's the only thing we can compare it to. And so what's your thoughts on that, AJ?
You know, as you were talking about both these incidents, I'm over here like writing notes just so I can remind myself about what I'm going to say once you're done. And something I wrote right before you asked me that question was, video without context equals false narrative. Mm. And I feel like that's something that we consistently run into, not only as law enforcement officers, but as community members as well, right? Like, there are plenty of videos out there of community members who are doing the right thing, and the context may not be out there that shows that you were doing the right thing, and then the community's painting a bad picture. But a lot of times, as a law enforcement officer, there's a video that gets released without the full or the proper context of what the video is showing, and it perpetuates this false narrative that police officers are out to do whatever, or that he did this because of that, or she did this because of this. But to touch on the Texas incident, when you were talking about it, two things popped into my head that really, I don't want to say bothered me, but really just made me think a lot about where we are as a nation. So one of the big things they talked about was she had a gun in her house. Okay. I'm telling you right now, if I'm in my living room, mm-hmm. and I hear somebody walking around my house, the first thing I'm going to do is grab my gun.
100%.
And if I hear you... And right, absolutely. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've heard something fall in the living room or in the kitchen. I grab my gun and I'm clearing the house, right? Like, I'm RoboCop. Yeah. Like, I'm cutting the corners and all of that, right? That is your place of rest. That is your house. That is your home. Like, you have the right to protect that and to protect yourself if someone comes inside to harm you, right? So with that said, so what? She had a gun. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know the facts. Did she point the gun at the officer? I don't know. Did she know he was an officer in the backyard? I don't know. The second thing, on the flip side of the same incident that I really stuck out to me, is a lot of people were trying to make it a race thing. I'm telling you right now, I firmly believe this. Once again, like, I don't know the officer. I don't know all the circumstances, but I highly doubt this officer would have went into the back of this house, in the back of his head, like, I'm gonna kill me a black person. Mm. I'm gonna kill me a black person. And like you said, right? Like, the officers could barely see through the window as is. Like, do you deep down inside believe that the officer looked in the window seen a woman of color and was like, yep, here it goes. Bow. Now you in prison for murder, especially with everything going on today. You know what I mean? We just had an incident in Texas. Like, you don't think that was in the back of his head? I think he made a mistake. I honestly think that he made a mistake that unfortunately he's going to have to pay for. Mm-hmm. And you know, that is what it is. Like, he's going to have to sit in the courtroom and talk to the judge and look that victim's family in their faces and say, look, this is what happened. Don't make an excuse. Once again, I wasn't there. I'm not trying to create a false narrative of what happened. But don't try to make her into a bad person. I don't know the details.
Well,
but don't try to put it in your favor.
So
if
let
it's
me
not.
Let me touch on that before you go to the Fresno one, because you brought up something that just reminded me of where I wanted to go with this a while back. And so what I need everybody listening to do right now is I need you guys to take a step back, and I need you to see and understand what, going back to culture, what we talked about at the beginning of this podcast, going back to culture, I need you to understand what the culture is trying to get you to do. So I'm going to read the first paragraph of a major news publishing company that put out, this is what they put out the day after that incident happened. It said, a black woman was shot and killed by a white police officer in Fort Worth, Texas, home after a neighbor called dispatchers to report the woman's front door was open, police said. And then the article goes on. But let me read that one more time. This was the first paragraph. A black woman was shot and killed by a white police officer in her Fort Worth, Texas home after a neighbor called dispatchers to report the woman's front door was open, police said. Now, let me change it up. Let me see if this does anything different. A woman was shot and killed by police in Fort Worth, Texas home after a neighbor called dispatchers to report woman's front door open, police said. Way different. So look what popular culture is trying to do. Like, did they have to say a black woman was shot by a white police officer? They didn't have to say that, but they did it. Why? Because they know that this is what's going to get people amped up. This is what's going to rev people up. They could have easily just said a woman was shot by police. And I guarantee you, had they said a woman was shot by police, it would have made people just be like, oh man, like, that's crazy. And I know what some of the naysayers are going to say is they're going to be like, no, then that would be trying to cover things up. No, it's not trying to cover things up. It's just, why do we always have to bring things back to race? Why? Like, why? I'm not saying that racism doesn't exist, because it does. I've said it exists before. But why do we have to purposely insert race into this? When, like you said, I don't think race played a factor in this. The dude, if they even said the windows were so glared out that it was hard to see inside that window. So it would be hard for him to even know maybe that this lady was even black. So why do we always have to insert race into stuff? And that's what just, and when you have a popular, you know, company like this, publishing company like this, that's putting stuff out there, it's almost like we're just being pigs led to the slaughter, just listening to all this false narrative and just saying, oh yeah, man, look, oh, see, it's because of this again, it's because they're black again, shut in your own home, we can't do nothing. No, you're just going in and you're leading into the popular belief. And that's why I'm so proud of my man, again, Kanye West, because he's coming out against that type of stuff, saying like, look, like, I'm going against what popular culture tells me to do. And that, I screenshotted that, because when I read that, bro, I was mad. I was like, why does it have to be read like that?
Yeah, absolutely. And just to further touch on why those two things stood out to me, the first thing that stood out was officers saying that she had a gun in her house. We have to hold each other accountable, right? Like, we have to stop trying to paint things in our favor when they're not. Maybe this isn't the case. Speaking in general, we have to stop that. That will continue to divide us and the community we serve further and further apart. And the second thing is how the community or whoever try to turn it into a race thing. We also have to stop. Like, if we as a world truly care about living in harmony and stopping this violence and stopping this hatred and these killings and these uses of force, then we have to stop doing these two things. We have to stop. Us as law enforcement officials, we have to hold ourselves accountable when we make a mistake. And us as community members, we have to stop automatically assuming that X, Y, and Z happened because whatever. We have to stop.
Yep.
We just have to.
Yep. And I want to give a shout out right now to anybody that does breakdowns. And I'm going to mention a few people. Mike the Cop, he's done a few of them. I do Tilma Takes all the time. There's a recent guy, I can't remember his name. If I get it before we get off of this podcast, I'll mention him. But I want to give you guys a shout out, because what you guys got to understand is what we've done with these breakdowns is, again, it goes against, you know, cultural, or, you know, it goes against, what's the popular, what's it called?
Yeah,
it goes against basically what's normal, I guess you can say. And so the reason I do Tillman Takes, again, is not to Monday morning quarterback stuff. That's not my intent. But you guys got to realize, in order to bridge this gap between law enforcement and the community has to see, like, hey, we're willing to, you know, learn from our mistakes, be able to actually visually just see that we made a mistake. Because a lot of times the community doesn't even think, like, they, in their minds, they think, like, we don't even think that a mistake was made. And so if they don't even think a mistake was made, then they're asking, like, well, where's the accountability piece? Like, if you guys can't acknowledge that a mistake was made, then where's the accountability piece of that? And, like, historically in law enforcement, for far too long, we got in this habit, and I understand why. Don't get me wrong. I understand why. But we got in this bad habit of saying, you know what, I'm not going to Monday morning quarterback it. And the reason we didn't want to do that, or we don't want to do that, is because we realize that tomorrow that could be us in the situation. So if you're a community member or a citizen, you have to understand why that we're so petrified and terrified to do that. Because it's not because we're afraid necessarily to speak out against bad cops. That's not it at all. The issue is that we recognize that tomorrow I can be put in a position that I may not want to be in. And my boy AJ was prime example of that. And so that's why we're petrified of doing some type of breakdowns or, you know, speaking out on situations before all the facts come out. It's because we recognize that we can be put in a situation tomorrow. However, saying all that to say this is that we as officers have to recognize, though, is that when something does go bad, something looks bad, something is bad, we can't always be hesitant to say, hey, look, it is bad. We can't do that because, again, it makes it look like we're trying to cover it up and sweep it under the rug. Like, what the community wants is accountability on our own behalf. And if we can't hold ourselves accountable, then who else is going to hold us accountable? So we have to recognize that. And so that's why I do Tillman's Takes. I always give the disclaimer anytime I do a Tillman's Take, is like, look, if there's facts that come out after this that prove me wrong, I will not be afraid to come out and say, hey, I was wrong. The reason I do Tillman's Takes is more so that way people get knowledge of what actually occurred. Because if you're not a police officer, then you're not even going to understand why they were there, what they were doing, what they were trying to do. The other reason I do a Tillman Take is because for officers, it's important for us to learn from other people's mistakes. And the reason it's important for us to learn from other people's mistakes is because learning from other people's mistakes could save your life, and it could save somebody else's life. And so it would be stupid if we didn't break down somebody else's video, because if we didn't do that, then we could make the same mistake for sure tomorrow if we didn't look at that. And so let me ask you, AJ, you've been on the flip side of that. And so you've been on the flip side of somebody that's critiqued. And I know recently it's popping back up because it's back in the headlines. And so everything I just said as far as, you know, breaking stuff down, doing, you know, breakdowns and stuff like that, is that something that you appreciate, or is that something that you're not really that for? And be honest, I know you will be, because me and AJ have had disagreements before. But, you know, how do you feel towards doing some of those breakdowns? And then how do you feel personally being at the center of attention in one of those breakdowns?
I love it, man. I loved it before my use of force incident, just because it allowed law enforcement to have a voice. And the reason I specifically say it allows law enforcement to have a voice and not everyone to have a voice is because we as law enforcement officials are bound by, you know, we have to be quiet because the investigation, or we're not allowed to talk about it because the investigation. So when you do these breakdowns and you're not affiliated with the department or the incident, you could say, hey, did you take this into consideration? Did you know about this? I got the inside scoop about this. And you really allow the officer to have a voice without having a voice. After my incident, man, I tell you what, dude, like, that was probably the top three toughest times of my life. And I've been through some stuff. And having brothers like you, Mike the Cop, Officer Daniels, there were even like some comedians who like famous comedians who like did their own breakdown of it. And some of them were neutral, some of them were bad, some of them were in my favor. But it just really allowed me to go, you know what? People are getting it, and people who have influence are using that influence to show people like, hey, I know the video may look bad, but did you take this in consideration? Or what about this? Or did you see this? Or, you know, the video doesn't really show this. So it really gives the voiceless a voice. So I love it, man. I'm a huge fan of the Tillman Take. I'm a huge fan of like what Mike the Cop does. You know, Officer Daniels posted something. You know, if you just take the time to break it down, and I'm not saying it has to be in the officer's favor, right? Like I'm not saying that at all. Like if the officer does something crazy and you're breaking it down, or maybe you don't even understand why officers do what they do, but like you just want to voice your opinion of it, as long as you're open to have a discussion about it. To me, that's where it starts.
So there's this dude named Sir Robert Peel. I think I've talked about him. He was the man back in the early 19th century or 1800s. I don't even know. But he was classified as the father of modern day policing. I always say one of my catchphrases that I've adopted is that I'm changing the face of modern day policing, because, you know, policing was a lot different in the 18th and 19th century than it is in the, you know, 21st century and all that other stuff. And so, you know, that's why I think the modern day policing needs a facelift. So, you know, one day y'all will say Sir Ryan Tillman Peel or whatever. but one of his principles, Sir Robert Peel had 9 principles. And principle number 7 says, police at all times should maintain a relationship with the public and gives reality to the historic tradition that police are the public and the public are the police being only members of the public who are paid to give full-time attention to the duties which are incumbent on every citizen and the interests of community welfare and existence. The reason I do Tillman's Takes is for that reason, and that reason alone is because even though I am a police officer, I'm still a member of the public. And like AJ said, is when I do Tillman's Takes, by no way am I representing the department I work for, but what I am representing is I'm representing being a member of the community, but has a job in police work. And so because I have a job in police work, that gives me a level of experience and training that the average civilian may not have. But at the end of the day, when I take my badge off, when I go home, I'm still a member of the public. And as a member of the public, I'm going to give you guys an educated opinion about what I believe happened in an incident that occurred involving some type of police use of force. That's why I do breakdowns, not because I want to get people to start talking, not because I want people to start beefing. It's because people are misguided. And if you're misguided, then you got to get your information from somewhere. And if you're going to get your information from articles out there that are saying, you know, white officer shoots black woman in home, then you're going to be misled. And so I choose now with social media and technology the way it is, I want to put out the right propaganda out there. And that's because I'm a member of the public, just like Sir Robert Peel said, man. So
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I have a question. And I'll ask you this question, Ryan, and then I really want our listeners or anybody who hears this or watches this to maybe like message us and answer this question as well. So I want you to picture your ideal police officer. Maybe he or she doesn't exist, right? Like I want you to really just close your eyes, take a minute and picture the perfect police officer in your eyes. So that perfect police officer that you just envision is doing his or her job. They're doing it flawlessly the way you would picture it. They go to a call or a run, or they encounter a combative subject and they do something that, you know, takes their life, right? Like they end up taking the life of somebody, but they probably shouldn't have. Do you think or do you feel that that perfect police officer that you envision should have grace?
100%.
100%. I do too.
And the reason too. I think that is I think they can have grace, but it still doesn't mean that they're actions shouldn't go unpunished. And so the grace piece for me is that I forgive you. I recognize it was an honest mistake, but there still has to be punishment.
So let me rephrase it. Do you think that the punishment should be as harsh or the same as if Joe Schmo did it?
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Okay.
100%. And the reason I think that is because, you know, and we have to, and that's the other thing, we have to equally compare it too from the standpoint of like, you know, if Joe Schmo did it, then Joe Schmo is going to get A, B, C, and D. And so if I am like trained to do something, it's kind of, that's a good question because it's kind of twofold. Because on one end, I'm trained. So therefore I'm trained. I shouldn't be making such mistakes like that. But on the other end, I'm put in a situation that Joe Schmo may not be in because I'm there to do something that's more riskier and all this other stuff, which also brings other elements into it. And so I think it should, you know, it's, and again, that goes back to, you have to judge every situation on an individual basis. Yeah, like you can't lump them all into one. I don't think so.
So the reason I put that question out there is it's something that I struggle with, and I'll be 100% transparent with everybody listening to this, is I am torn between the answer. Like I'm torn when it comes to that question. And that's exactly why, like, if you have, and keep in mind, this is your officer that you, man, this officer is just perfect. Like, he or she does X, Y, and Z flawlessly every single day. They have a heart of gold. They do everything for the right reason. They made an honest mistake doing their job, trying to protect whatever. I'm not sure I 100% believe that they should be punished to the fullest. But at the same breath, I do want things to be even across the table. So I'm torn.
It's
I'm
a hard torn. One, bro. I'm just interested to see hard it is.
What your like, view of that is.
Like, think about how hard it is. On the flip side of that, if I'm the family member that lost a life, like, I'm going to feel like there needs to be something done. But the police officer in me is like, bro, if I go out tomorrow and get spooked or do something and end up killing somebody, and like, imagine this. Let's not even imagine the perfect police officer. Take me and AJ. You guys, as long as you guys have been listening to us, you guys know our heart, where our heart is as far as bridging the gap between law enforcement and the community. If one of us went out there tomorrow and accidentally killed somebody, how would y'all want us to be tried?
Yeah, yeah. And you know, you use this as an example. Say we're driving in a cruiser, lights and sirens to a run, right? We lose control of our car, we smack another car and seriously injure somebody. How do you want that to be handled? We were going to a run, to somebody was breaking in a house, right? We're coming to your house. We are en route to your house that's being broken into. You called 911 because somebody kicked your front door in. We're running lights and sirens. We want to get there because we want to save you from being hurt. We lose control of our vehicle, get into an accident, and seriously hurt somebody. What do you think should happen?
I don't know.
It's a tough one. It's a tough one, right? Because like you said, like, we're trained, but we're humans. Maybe something malfunctioned with the car, you know? And like you said, like, we're placed in situations that Joe Schmo is not placed in. Joe Schmo shouldn't be driving like that, right?
I know.
Joe Schmo be driving like that.
It's a tough one, bro.
It's a tough one.
It hits close to home. It hits close to home in many ways. So, in many, many ways. So,
yeah, so I just want
to say on that one.
Yeah. So, I honestly just want the listeners, the viewers, to answer that because I'm torn.
I think it's circumstantial. Honestly, like, it goes back to, like I said, like, we can't throw a punishment. Punishment is due. You know, that's biblical. But if we do go back to the Bible, I mean, God extends grace to everybody. So level of grace, no matter how bad it is, should be extended. Now, is it easier said than done? 100%. So, you know, Billy, where are we at on time?
1 hour.
Okay. What I want to do real quick is briefly, I want to get into, I just want to read a positive thing, man. This was cool, man. And so, you know, we'll get in the habit of starting to read some stuff out. So a while back, I think it was in September, right when football season started. Speaking of football, how's your fantasy team doing, bro? Sidetrack squirrel.
I'm gonna talk about it. Yeah, I don't even want to talk about it, man.
I'm still in the running of mine. But
man,
whew. So hey, but your Buckeyes are still playing good. So at least that,
the Buckeyes are animal, man. Hey, yeah. Bro, I have Cousins as my backup quarterback, and he's been tearing it up. And Dak is my primary quarterback that I keep in, and it's just it's been, man. We'll talk about it later.
Oh man. So anyways, back in September, I had the honor of being on NBC, recognized as the hometown hero. But when me and the Savage went down to NBC Studios, we met a lady who did my makeup, and her name was Lisa. And me and Lisa got to talking, African-American lady, really, really nice lady. And the only reason I bring up African-American, again, not to make this about race, but there is a point I want to make about this. But we got to talking, and, you know, she was just a sweetheart, just really, really nice, you know. And so we were talking, I was talking to her about the podcast and stuff, and she said she's a podcast listener and yada, yada, yada. And so I was like, hey, you know, check out our podcast. And she's like, oh, okay, I'll definitely do it. And so when people tell me that, sometimes I think they're just trying to give me lip service so that way I can stop talking to them. But she went and listened to our podcast, and she sent me, I need to respond to her today too, but she sent me an email. I'm going to respond to her as soon as we get done, actually, Billy. So, you know, Lisa, if you're listening to this, this is for you. So she said, Ryan, I met you at KNBC when you were a hero on the show The Challenge. I was the makeup artist that worked on you. I promised to listen to your podcast, and I have been blown away with all the knowledge I have gained from it. Not only about law enforcement, but life. The life lessons you guys have shared are amazing to me. I am literally yelling amen all the time on my commute. I laugh, I cry. People probably think I'm crazy in my car. This podcast has changed my views about law enforcement so much. I, too, was a person that would blame all police for a few bad ones. People don't blame all makeup artists because one did a bad job on them. This opened my eyes. I have always been respectful, but in the back of my head, I did not like them or trust them. I grew up in Oakland, and there are some different types of police there. I hope more people will listen and realize that we are all human, and at the end of the day, you're all people too. I have so much to say about this amazing podcast, but this email would be a book. Instead, I will share with friends. I pray for all of you on the show, for your safety, being amazing people and family men. I am a single mother, so I love to hear doting dads who are present in their children's lives. My daughter is an amazing child because I have aligned her with some pretty amazing stand-in father figures / mentors. I thank you and salute you, Lisa. Lisa, first and foremost, thank you, because that message, as soon as I saw that, I sent it out to our team that produces this podcast, AJ and the Savage, and it encouraged us to continue to push on. The other thing, and the reason I brought up the fact that you were African-American, is because me being African-American as well, and just being a minority in general, I know that a lot of times the current climate in our minority community against law enforcement is a negative stigma. And so the fact that you were able to open your eyes and, you know, take an unbiased approach, an unbiased view, and just listen in with an open heart instead of, you know, saying, oh, man, it's a cop podcast, I'm not listening to that. That just really made my heart melt, because I appreciate you and people like you that are changing the world, and you're going to help change your daughter's world if you already are, because you're going to give your daughter, you know, those leadership skills that she needs to have an unbiased look and unbiased opinion on certain things, so she can make her own educated opinion on, you know, life issues as we deal with them. So thank you, Lisa. That really, really made my day, touched my heart so much, I can't tell you. And we get stuff like this all the time, messages. And so I'm sorry I haven't read your message out, but I just want to thank every single one of you guys that sends us those positive messages on our Instagram. And forgive me if I have not been able to reach back to you on Instagram. It's not because I'm trying to big time you. It's not because I'm trying to shine you. It's just there's a lot going on. And so I just got to make sure that I'm prioritizing. So thank you, Lisa.
Yeah, Lisa, that's, yeah, we love it, keep it coming. Funny fact, every time I hear the name Lisa, I think of the Simpsons episode where the jazz player was singing, Lisa, it's your birthday. Happy birthday, Lisa.
Hey, hey, yeah. Lisa, let me know when your birthday is. Let us know because we sing it to you.
We
Lisa,
got you.
It's your birthday. Hey, I'm going to look that up, man. So, oh, man. You got any parting words, fair fouls, motivation for our listeners before we get up out of here, AJ?
I got a quick fair foul. And then I do have some motivation, absolutely have some motivation. So I'll make this quick. So as y'all know, actually, y'all were the first to find out because that's how much we care about y'all who listen to this podcast. My wife is pregnant, all right? And she's going to kill me for this, but I have to share it. So this past weekend, it's Sunday. There was like the Columbus Marathon was going on. So like all the roads are shut down. So my wife, she's like, you know what? I'm going to let you sleep in because I work until 3:30. I work pretty late most Saturdays. So she's like, I'm gonna let you sleep in, you know, we could watch church online, blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, bet. She's like, I'm gonna make you, some breakfast, blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, all right, cool. So I'm asleep. All of a sudden, dogs start barking, and our dog don't bark unless like somebody's at the door, somebody just came in. Something has to be up for our dog to be barking, right? So I hear the dog barking, and I hear my wife like make a noise like, oh. So I'm like, oh, snap. So, you know, going back to what we were talking about earlier, I grab my gun. I come running out in the living room. I'm wiping sleep out my eyes. And she's in the kitchen. And she's okay. And the dog's like wagging his tail. And I'm like, what's going on? So I'm like frustrated. Yeah, so I'm frustrated. So I throw my gun on the bed. And I'm like, I got to use the restroom. So I'm using the restroom. And all of a sudden, I start smelling like burnt plastic. And I'm like, man, what's that smell? It's getting stronger and stronger. And the dog start barking again. So then I hear my wife go, babe. So I'm like, oh, snap. Like, so something ain't right. So I come running out the bathroom. My wife, my beautiful, intelligent, perfect, flawless wife.
I like decided, how you gave all the precursors.
I have to. She decided to put the air fryer. Like, you know, you have an air fryer, you put chicken or whatever
in.
She put the air fryer on top of the stove and then turned the stove on. So now she said it was an accident. She said she stood on there and then somehow the knob turned. We got a ghost in the apartment. So the ghost turned the knob and turned the stove on. But it almost caught the air fryer on fire. So here I am, like, I'm trying to process this. I just woke up. I'm tired. I'm like, is the air fryer on top of the stove? And then the stove is on. So at that point, it's off, but there's still, like, black smoke, right? So I'm like, oh, snap. So my number one concern is, like, get my pregnant wife out of the place, the kitchen, right? Like, she breathing in this smoke. So I'm like, go outside. And she's like, no, let me take care of it. And I'm like, arguing. I'm like, go outside. Like, I'm, babe, like, we'll talk about this later. Like, you got my kid breathing in some smoke right now, some plastic smoke. So, yeah, that's my fair file. Like,
hey,
she's pregnant. She said it was an accident. Like,
hey, bro. Hey, I'm going to go fair with that one, bro.
Oh,
I'm
going to
go fair with that one. And I'm going fair on Shelby half. She just tried to make her baby some breakfast. She tried to do her best job. And here go AJ.
I know, and that's the funny thing about it. We're sitting on the patio. We're eating like the food that she was able to make. And she just looks at me, and she's sad, right? She's sad. She's just looking at me. She's like, "I'm never making you breakfast again." I'm like, "How is this my fault? Like, I don't even use the air fryer." Like,
hey, over there being petty, eating the burnt bacon and stuff. Like,
this tastes like plastic.
I'm going fair on Shelby's half because she just wanted to make her baby some breakfast. It's okay,
Billy,
Shelby.
Billy,
I got
Billy,
you.
I know you can hear me. What you thinking? Fair or foul?
Bianca said pregnancy brain is a real thing because the exhaustion, you just like stop thinking.
That's what I'm thinking happened. And she even said it. She was like pregnancy brain, ha ha ha. And I'm like, nah. Like, you about burn the place down.
Hey, bro.
It's my wife, so I'm gonna go fair too. I just had to put her business out there.
Oh, man.
So my motivation today, I don't even know if you really use this as motivation, but I just want to encourage everyone out there to have a discussion. And whether or not the discussion is about law enforcement, whether or not the discussion is about race, sexual orientation, like you name it, just have a discussion and be open to having that discussion with somebody that doesn't share the same views as you. And maybe surround yourself by someone who thinks completely opposite of you and be willing to have that dialogue with that person, because that's where it starts. There's so many times where us as law enforcement officials, we feel that we are right in so many aspects of our jobs that we're not willing to have a discussion or a dialogue with community members. And it's the same way, right? It's a double-edged sword. There's so many community members out there who feel victimized, and you know, we're killed by the numbers, and we're hunted because of our race and whatever, but they're not open to having a dialogue with police officers on why they do what they do. And I'm a firm believer that the moment we are able to sit down and have a true dialogue about anything will be the moment that we could grow as individuals. Even if we agree to disagree, maybe I'll understand why you feel the way you feel, and you'll understand the way I feel, how I feel. So my motivation to you today, maybe it's not motivation, it's more of a challenge, is to just have a dialogue with somebody. Find somebody that's different than you, that looks different than you, that's a different sex, that's a different whatever religion, and have a dialogue with them. Have a cup of coffee, break bread with them, find out who they are, why they are, what they are, and whatever, and just grow. Let's grow together.
Man, drop the mic. So I'm gonna tell y'all a funny story real quick, and then I'm gonna leave y'all with my nuggets. So I told y'all how sick I was. I'm not gonna try to get all, you know, give y'all TMI, but sick, bruh. So have you ever seen Friday?
Have I ever seen Friday? Yeah, I seen Friday.
Billy was like, huh?
Billy ever seen Friday?
Billy said, yes, he has seen Friday. He has seen Friday. So let me just paint the picture for y'all, bro. So last Sunday, it takes an act of God to not do the podcast, guys. And this day was that act of God. So Sunday morning, we were going to record podcast Monday morning, actually. And Sunday night is when I start getting sick. Going into Monday morning, it was just terrifying. So whole family was sick, bro. Whole family. I'm like throwing up all over the place, you know. And then the other side, you know, was draining. We just put it like that, bro. So anyway, I don't think I told either one of you guys this. So I'm getting personal with y'all. Some of y'all gonna be mad. Some of y'all might stop following us because like, oh, that was too disgusting. But anyways, so I go to Walgreens at 3 o'clock in the morning, bro, because I'm like, I need to get some ginger ale. I need to get some Pedialyte. I need to get some Gatorade. I need the works, bro. Like, not only do I need the works, my baby needs the works. My baby was just throwing up like 8-9 times, bro. It was just bad. Everybody, bro. So I go to Walgreens. I'm like, okay, we're going to do this. So I back out of the park, back out of my garage, get down the street. I'm like, dang, I forgot my phone. So I get my phone, go back home, get my phone. And it's 2 o'clock in the morning, bro. So I'm not going to lie to you. I'm speeding. I'm like, hey, I got to get there, bro. My stomach is still turning right now. I'm on, time is of the essence right now, bro. Because I don't know when duty may call for that bathroom again. I don't know. Time is of the essence. So I'm driving fast, bro. I get to Walgreens because Walgreens is like the only thing open at this time of the morning. So I get there, I pull up, and why at like 3 o'clock in the morning, you still got folks out like doing nothing? I'm like, man, like, why? Like, me and Billy always talk about this too. Every time we record, bro, we could be in the Mojave Desert, bro, and we're trying to make wait for like a good background, and then all of a sudden you see like somebody, a little kid on their big wheel in the Mojave Desert pop up out of nowhere. So like, right. Same thing like, on this day, bro. Like, what are you doing? It's 3 o'clock in the morning, and nobody should be out right now. It should just be the clerk inside. So I get to the parking lot. As I park, bro, I just start feeling nauseous. I'm like,
ooh, oh, the Lord. Bubble guts.
Duh. I'm like, both bubble guts and nauseousness. I'm like, oh, this is terrible, bro. So I'm like, okay, you know what? I got to reposition my car to the back of this parking lot, bro, because I'm going to throw up in a minute. It's coming, bro. So I put my car back in drive, bro. I start driving. As I drive, bro, I open my door, like fling that thing open like there's somebody shooting at me, bro. I'm like, I gotta get out, and I just start like throwing it all over the parking lot, bro.
Betrayal,
bro. Right. So I'm like, I didn't even make it to a parking stall, bro. Like, I like parked like sideways, bro. I had a blinker on. I think I hit the blinker as I opened the door, bro. It's just like, oh man. So then, like, I get to the other parking lot. My wife would kill me for saying this. Like, that, why would you tell people that? So I get to the parking lot, bro. And I got the bubble guts bad, bro. Like, bad, bro. Like, bad, bro.
Oh, I'm dying.
So the reason I led this conversation with, have you ever seen the movie Friday, bro?
Do you remember Smokey back here taking...
Dog. Yes. So. I'm not gonna tell y'all. If you've never seen the movie, then you guys gotta watch the movie to know what I'm talking about. But if you've seen the movie Friday, bro, that was me behind my car, bro. Oh. No kidding, bro. Like, yeah, Billy's eyes got wide, bro. Duh, like I was not gonna make it, bro. Like, no, like, I thought people made that stuff up, bro, when they say, like, nah, bro, like, you can control yourself. You a grown man, bro. You a grown, and in my mind, I'm telling myself, like, bro, you a grown man, bro. You should be able to control your stuff. This time, bro, just the pure, you know, oh, I was just like, all pride lost out the window, bro. All everything just lost that day, bro. All sense of, you know, freaking honor, all sense of pride, all sense of manhood.
Out the window. Out the window. Hey, out when you get to that window. Point, you just gotta, duh. You know?
So I tell y'all that, that's why we couldn't do the podcast, bro. I would be doing a disservice, bro. So fair or foul, bro, that I just lost all sense of, you know, humility in that situation, bro. But
so yeah. I think we have the name of the podcast, Huggies.
Oh,
that's the name. Bro, that's the name of the podcast, Huggies.
Huggies. Oh, question mark, up, bro. I needed something that day, bro. I came back when I got back with all the everything in the store. I had this mad look on my face. The lady at the courtesy clerk. She was like, "Hey, how you doing?" I was like, "Give me the stuff, please. Just." Like
it's a crappy day.
Oh man! So, lastly, let me give off a few nuggets. Yeah, it is a crappy day. It is a crappy. Yeah, it's a. Really
dad doom, joke. Doom, doom.
He already got dad jokes coming. Baby ain't even here. He got the dad jokes popping.
Coming in hot.
I see you. So, just real quick, few nuggets. One of the things I do on my notepad is I just write down a few nuggets. Sometimes I'm driving, I'm thinking about different things. And shout out to the person that hit me up recently that was talking about the nugget that I gave you guys about applying pressure to the wound. Somebody hit me up and said that really just resonated with them. So, thank you for listening to our podcast. Here's a few more nuggets that I wrote down just throughout my week. Fear doesn't motivate. Relationships do. So if you're an officer out there, I don't want you guys to think that you can motivate people by fear. People will not respond to fear, especially in this day and age with this younger generation that we're dealing with. People will not respond to fear. They will respond with relationships. So if you want people to do something for you, develop relationships, and not just a relationship, develop genuine relationships. The next nugget, we need to stop teaching police officers to be scared, and we need to teach them to be more confident. And what I mean by that is that doesn't say that we cannot get scared, because there's been, don't get me wrong, there's been times I've been freaking real scared in our job, but we can't be taught to be scared. There's a difference. We need to be taught to be confident, to rise to the, you won't rise to the occasion. You're going to fall back on the level of your training. But what you can do is you can train yourself to be confident. And the way you do that is through your training. So as police officers, let's get really, really good at training. So that way we can avoid some of the mistakes that have been made in recent time, like in Texas when we're shooting people through windows. The next nugget, influence is beyond your social media platform. So don't just think that influence comes because you have a large following on social media. Your influence goes beyond that. Your influence goes into your day-to-day work. Your influence goes into your family. Your influence goes wherever you go is where your influence goes. And so remember that influence goes beyond your social media platform. And the last thing I'll leave you guys with is I want to do it right. That doesn't mean I have to be right. And so take this, and this goes back into what AJ said, is that we want to get things done the right way, but that doesn't necessarily mean I need to be right. And as police officers, sometimes I think we get in this trouble is saying, like, man, like we get in this mode of like, nah, I got to be right. Like, nah, this is my way. Like, we can still get done, things done the right way without having to be right. And so just take that as a nugget, no matter whether you're a police officer, whether you're a civilian, whether you're a citizen, a lot of the arguments we have is because we're just trying to be right. So Stop always trying to be right and realize that there's a right way to get to the solution, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be right and give the solution that's going to get us to that right solution. And so those are just some of the nuggets that I think about on my day-to-day basis. I write them down on my notepad just because I'm always thinking. And so just take those nuggets however you guys want to. We appreciate you guys following us on this podcast. You guys have been phenomenal. It feels good to be back. I know we went a little long today. Breaking Barriers United, y'all. And hey, I always say this, and I think y'all just think I'm just blowing smoke when I say we blowing up. Somebody else, just so you guys know, I'm not just saying this. I talked to somebody yesterday, and they were like, man, like, Ryan, like, 2019, you guys are like, it almost seems like you guys blew up. And me, AJ, and the Savage said at the beginning of 2019, we're going to take this thing to another level, and we're going to blow it up. No, we legitimately have been blowing it up. And so, for sure. I want to tell you guys, man.
Like you did the parking lot at Walgreens.
Yes. Just like the parking lot. Hey, what's that thing called? Remember on Instagram, we put up that funny meme when she was like, somebody said they finna blow it up? Yes, bro. Just like the Walgreens parking lot, BBU is fitting to blow up. Hey, that's inside joke. Just like the Walgreens parking lot, bro, BBU is fitting to blow up, bro. So we are blowing up. I got to tell y'all something, man. If y'all have not heard, you guys will be hearing soon. Let me just throw this word out there, or these two words, BBU Productions. That's all I can say, but BBU Productions. So that's that. The other thing is, it's that time of the year, guys. We are approaching November soon, which means it's needed. Conference time planning is going to be getting underway. So, yes, sir. We will be hosting another conference next year, and we will be starting to plan very, very soon here. Me and AJ doing a lot of speaking still. We'll be getting together soon. So a lot of good stuff coming. Thank you guys for the support. Halloween, I believe, is next week. Man, have a safe and fun Halloween. And I think me, AJ, and the Savage will probably get some costumes up, put them up for you guys to vote on. I hope you guys liked our dance video with Spider-Man and Darth Vader or whatever it was. And then also, I hope y'all like AJ's video announcement, the baby announcement that we made for him. So, yeah, we've been on a roll lately.
Yeah, that was a good one.
We've been on a roll lately. Any last party words, AJ? You good?
I think we killed it, brother.
Hey, man, we love you guys. We thank you guys. We appreciate everything. And Billy, do me a favor, bro. Take us out on some Kanye. It ain't Chick-fil-A. Is that how the song goes? I don't know.
Closed on Sunday. You're my Chick-fil-A.
Hey, close us out on that. All right. We'll see you guys next week.
Peace.
Hold the selfies. Put the gram away. Get your family, y'all hold hands and pray. When you got daughters.